The people who know me really well refer to me as Jessie. They think Jessie is just a reflection of who you are. Recently when we shot a film, Manoj said, sir, unga style la pannala, sir. So I said, what? Another half montage. Then only realized that there's a pattern now. I didn't want to show who she's married to at the end of the film. It's a call that we took on the edit table.
So Gautham, I'll begin with the love at first sight trope, right? Now the Samantha character later in the movie, Vinnaithaandi, she kind of tells the Simbu character that she loves him. But then you say that a year has passed. So and then she says, you know, yappo nadandhen therla, I'm in love with you, whatever. But when it comes to Simbu and Trisha, it's like a love at first sight trope, right? Given the depth of what this boy goes through, did you wonder about maybe establishing another way of him falling in love in a more slightly, maybe a little more deeper way? The reason I ask is, or do you feel, you know, you just wanted to let him fall in love and then like get that out of the way so that the deeper part of parts of the film can unfold?
So it's happened to me, which is why I thought it's okay to be in that space. I know it doesn't happen to everybody. Some people might find it a little ridiculous even. But I just felt, like today also somebody asked me, how does it work? I said, it's just being in the right place at the right time. That's about how everything else in life also works for me. You sit with Rehman sir, you sit with Karthik, you sit with Darbuka Shiva, Harris Jayaraj and Raja sir. It's not necessary that every time, you know, they have to come out with stuff that I like. But so far, that's the only thing that's happened. You inspire them a little bit, you're in the right place at the right time, and what they give you, you take. So that was the moment that I was trying to figure out. They move in from, you know, a place where they have to move out and they stay in this place temporarily where the house is being constructed. Right. So that was being in the right place at the right time for me. So he was there. He's jobless, he's got a degree in everything, but he's still not set out. And she just walks past him, and that's all it took for him to actually first be sort of enveloped by the whole moment.
Right.
And then, you know, listening to her voice, just looking at her, it keeps growing a little more.
Right.
Whereas with Samantha, I didn't do that also because he's with Jessie. So when he meets Samantha, it's nice. She's working with him. They're ADs together on this film and stuff like that. But there's no way, you know, he'll take it forward only because Jessie's strongly. But for her, also it was not on day one. If you notice, it takes 1 hour for her to say, "Yeppa naradhu therla, but I like you."
Yeah, yeah,
you know,
so.
So it works differently for people across the film itself is what I was trying to say.
Okay, no, I definitely get that. But what I'm trying to say is, given that so many films, of course it's possible that love at first sight happened. My question is just from a filmmaking viewpoint, because so many films have shown this, did you kind of, you know, it doesn't bother you that
no.
Okay.
I think the whole treatment, Rehman sir's music,
right.
When I narrated this idea to him, what he came up with was so inspiring that the on paper the song itself was, he just flips over the gate and he lands in this place where, you know, it's just him and, you know, he's walking around feeling the whole moment.
Right.
And there's churches and, you know, the motives of the whole Christian thing coming up. And he came up with Hosanna. So I don't think there was any two ways about it. You know, there was no discussion at all about that whole going for the moment kind of thing.
You mentioned Rehman. So I have this question to ask you. This, when they meet for the first time, he sees her, she comes in, and he doesn't know that Trisha is coming to the house.
Yeah.
You do away with the dialogue, and the entire thing has only background score.
Yeah.
What made you decide to do that?
The background score.
Right.
It was a call that I took on the mix when I sat and I heard this, you know, the piece that he'd composed and what was given to me. We mixed at his studio only upstairs. I just decided to do away with everything, you know, and maybe just the rustle of the wind and stuff like that. Other than that, it's just the score. Yeah.
Okay.
So music inspires you to do that.
Okay. So you had recorded dialogue earlier.
Yeah, we had recorded dialogue earlier. We dubbed for it also. And there was a voiceover also, which we sort of, you know, mixed it with the music. It's so long ago, I still remember, you know, most aspects, which is, okay, thanks, you know, your memory is alive and stuff.
Yeah.
But you know, otherwise, this is a film that I loved working on. It was never a film that I should have recreated. And that was a big mistake. And this is going out to lots of young filmmakers there. Just because the commercials seem nice and then you have an opportunity to make a film in Hindi, it will never come. There are certain films like Aruvi and all, you can never remake that film again.
Right.
To a large example, even Kakakaka, even though I had an opportunity to work with Venkatesh and it was a very good Telugu film in that sense. There are some films that just grow out, you know, from inside you. You set it up with the actor, the cameraman is candid. lots of moments when Simbu and Trisha are talking, right. They didn't even know the camera was running, in spite of the fact that we were shooting in film at that time, you know. So it should never be recreated. And I remember lots of moments from the film straight away.
So this moment in the church when he goes to meet her for the first time in church, and he refers to the Manisha Kerala bit in Bombay. Was that a little homage to Maniratna?
Yeah, but I don't know how many people got it. Yeah. You being you who you are, I think you got it even then. I asked Simbu, Simbu didn't know what I was talking about. So I said, bro, on the soundtrack, it's so popular, it's still in my head. Whenever Manisha Kerala walks by, Rahman sir's background score kicks in. And then once I reminded him of it, he got the tune. Because he had to actually sing right. the tune and recreate that in the dubbing studio also.
Right.
So I made him, it's just that for me, it's a great moment. When I saw the film, that's how I felt, you know. And then in college and later, we used to talk about the score there. So for me, when I was writing it, by the moment that this girl arrives, the score, you know, being a filmmaker, automatically the score would come up to him also, you know. Right, so, right. yeah.
So Jessie is just this most amazing character ever, because usually you find a person with, like, who has one obstacle to overcome, and then that's fine. Usually the parent or something or something. But here it's like a constant up, down, up, down. So I have a few questions about what I call Jessie's mood chart. So I'm going to point out various moments in Jessie, yeah. what of things that Jessie does, and I just like to know what you thought when you wrote those moments, right?
This will be easy, you know why? Because the people who know me really well refer to me as Jessie. They're saying Jessie is just a reflection of who you are.
Okay.
And Simbu is somebody else that you're not. So this right. will be easy. But.
So when she sees him in church and she says, "Come home," and then you know, meet my entire extended family. What is going through her mind then?
She's just hoping. Firstly, she's enamored by the fact that he's come all the way.
Right.
They've met earlier. She's seen him around. There's a hi, hello. On the terrace, they've met. She's seen him around. He's walked with her. He ends up even telling her, you know, "I like you." And he right. blabbers his way through.
"I'm in love with you, Jessie."
Later, she's not anywhere to be seen. His sister tells him that she's traveled. She's gone there. He decides he just needs to go there and apologize to her for saying that. "I goofed up." But she's enamored by the fact that he came all the way to say this. From then on, she's opened up to him. She's hoping that she can just introduce him as one of her classmates right. and the family will get to like him straight away. And then maybe the whole religion angle won't play later. That's what's in her mind.
That's what's in her mind, right. She first says her dad won't allow a Hindu. And then she brings up the fact that there's an age difference. And finally she says, "Yanakona pudikaname." Is this kind of, you know, like that her thing comes last?
No, it's a step-by-step process where Simbu's voiceover that begins at the beginning of the film, this is how I wrote it, saying how problems keep adding up. It's okay. just that.
Right.
Right. But this moment happened to me only with Jessie. Firstly, they're Christians. And then she's 1 year older than me. And then her brother doesn't like me. So it's just that. It was the step-by-step things that that crop up in the process of that relationship sort of thing. It was intentional.
Okay. Then she talks about how her older sister ran away and her father brought her back.
Yeah.
And then now the older sister is actually happy in that arranged marriage with a kid.
And
then
that's what she's saying,
right? Yeah. And he says, no, but the thing is there a part of her that feels, okay, so even for me, if I get into a marriage like that, it's going to be okay?
That's what I think she does at the end of the film. And I didn't want to show who she's married to at the end of the film. It's a call that we took on the edit table. I decided to leave that like a loose end because I thought, one, the audience, it'll be too heartbreaking for them to see who she finally married. And let's just leave it open.
Okay.
I don't think she ever believes that she'll be okay.
Okay.
More than anything else, it's the whole fact that it's not going to be happy. Whatever it is, she's been with her parents who've been with her for like 25 years. She's gone through their way of life with them.
Right.
She wants him. She takes that step. She meets him secretly. She calls off her wedding because she knows it's not going to be happy at all. But then she sees the trauma at home. She sees the unrest at home.
Right.
And then she takes a call. There is one moment in the film that's so, maybe not so clearly defined, which we define better in the Hindi version, but nobody saw the Hindi version, where she decides to leave home that night.
Right.
She takes a call. There's a bus that comes to pick her up, you know, on her.
Which night?
One night she decides to leave home.
Okay.
There's a bus that comes to pick her up. So she leaves in the morning. And then she keeps calling him. He doesn't pick up her calls because he's shooting with K.S. Ravi Kumar sir and it's chaos and stuff like that. In the Hindi, the script had it that she goes to the airport with her ticket without any clue as to where she should go and keeps calling him. He doesn't answer. And that moment is gone for her. So in the Tamil film, we just made her saying, which has made her say, I left, but that moment is gone now. I wasn't able to reach you.
Another word, not a poor chick. That moment is gone.
So she just goes through this, you know, back and forth. That's the character.
Right. So the part where she says, let's be friends. Why encourage him at all?
Because that's how I am.
Okay.
So you want to be in that space with somebody.
Right.
You know it's going to be chaos. But you don't want to let him go.
Okay, okay.
You're hoping, and I think lots of people are there like that.
Yeah.
You want to hold somebody's hand. You know you don't want to cross a line because of the situation around you. But that line is really tempting to cross, you know.
Yeah, so, yeah. So that's it. Yeah. Okay. The rebellious streak that she kind of calls off the wedding, and then she lies deliberately to her dad, knowing that, just to get Simbu out of jail. That rebellious streak happens because she's by then decided that she wants this guy.
Yeah.
Okay.
And there's no looking back after that till she's not able to reach him, and then she knows it's going to be chaos. She talks to her father one more time. He says he'll be over my dead body.
Right.
And then she just decides, you know, let's just be polite and safe about this and let's move on.
Right. Right.
The thing is, that rebellious streak was always in her, I thought, with the small, small things that she does.
Right.
You know, so we... Yeah, it's one... I don't know. In fact, Trisha, when she saw the film finally... She said, Gautham, am I a negative character in the film? Will people hate me? I said, either they'll hate you trash or, you know, they'll just love you for being in a very different film. That's all I said. I don't know what finally came out.
No, it came across as a very human character.
Correct.
Yeah. You know, not positive or negative. Of course, one wouldn't want to be at the receiving end. But one definitely, I think everyone walked away with the fact that, you know, she had her problems. This part where she says, I want you, I want lots of love, lots of happiness. So she's kind of, is that a point where we realize that if this guy does not happen for her, then she's never going to be happy again?
Yeah.
Is that the...
Yeah. So I've known somebody in my life who said, in a similar kind of situation, saying if I can't have him and be with him, then I won't have anybody else in life.
Right.
I wanted to toe that line to a large extent, but then I thought it's also not practically out there, you know. Finally, the two people whom I'm talking about actually ended up being together with the parents agreeing.
Okay.
Once the girl took a stand saying, you know, if not him, then nobody else in my life forever.
Right.
Then the parents, in spite of being Christians and the boy being a Hindu, they kind of agreed and decided and came around, and there was a mutual understanding and stuff like that.
Right.
But in this film, I think, you know, I didn't want to go down that exact route. It'll be very close to home and stuff, so... So I just decided to play it like that.
So for me, in this Jessie's mood chart, my favorite moment is when after Goa, he comes back to her house and she kind of, you know, comes and meets him downstairs. And she says two things, you know. One, she says, "Yennala onakkenda kashtama irukka koodadhu." Okay, so she's thinking about him. And then she also says, "Avanga enna verukkuradha vida nee enna verukkuradhu better." So she's also thinking about her parents to some extent. Yeah. So that entire thing about the tug of war is summarized there. Yeah. I mean, did you kind of have that in mind when you wrote that?
Yeah, stuff? That first line was referring to the fact that she was actually calling him in the middle of the shoot. You know, and the calls keep coming. He keeps cutting the line. The director stares at him, then admonishes him. Then the Ganesh character tells him, "Lila sir, I'm Pavo," and all that stuff.
Right.
And this happens on sets. You know, the phone goes off.
Right.
Everybody looks at you like that. You know, it's almost like blasphemy on the sets, right? So that's what she means. You were stuck somewhere. You're working for 10 days. But I know you would have thought of me wondering how to take this forward. I don't want that to be around.
Right, right.
And somewhere, I think in your creative space, you need to be by yourself is how most people think with us filmmakers.
Yeah.
The second part definitely is what she's seeing at home at every point. No, she knows the minute she crosses the line, it's over between her and her father, and to a large extent her mother also.
Right.
They would, and I've seen families like that. They completely cut off. Even after children are born, it takes a long time for them to sort of reconcile and accept and stuff. So she doesn't want to go through that.
So one unusual thing in this film is usually when filmmakers want to show the fact that the girl does not want to oppose her father or mother, they usually take extra care to show lots of scenes with the father or mother showing how like deep the bond is. But you kind of pretty much do away with it. There's practically very few scenes with the father and daughter in that loving space or whatever it is, you know?
I know.
That was again a deliberate thing?
Or? No, I think it's just a miss. Maybe we should have.
No, I mean, I didn't feel it as a miss. I was wondering what...
No, I'm actually thinking of it for the first time.
Okay.
I just felt in her lines that would sort of be conveyed.
Right.
And maybe the fact that Babu Antony plays the dad, you know, I didn't sort of picturize that in my head, maybe.
Okay. Tell me about this line. She says, "Vali enak romba pidikum, inda vali enak romba pidichirukku." What that bit about her? She's a masochist.
So that's again me, I think. People who know me will say yes.
Okay.
I felt she'd say this in a heartbeat, you know. Right. It's just that, it is again that night sequence where she tells him, just let this go. When he asks her, will you be able to, she says, I like this pain, I want to move on with that pain. Strangely, that's what takes him forward in his life, and he makes a film. That pain that he went through, you know, this one-way ticket to Heartbreak City and all that stuff. That what he converts into his life now, he's made a film on something that happened in his life.
Right.
And finally, a filmmaker's dream is to make a film and then move on, hopefully make more films, right?
Yeah.
They both understood that pain very easily. And that's the sort of a pivotal line where he also understands what she's talking about.
One almost got the feeling that at the end, between him on one side and the dad on one side, an arranged marriage is probably the easiest way out for her, you know. This is kind of neither one suffers.
Yeah, so the other thought that went in while we discussed this was, or maybe now she said finally yes to somebody who was living in the US because she wanted to go there and stuff. I said, see, in today's age, that's not a big deal. Maybe in the 70s.
Somebody said this to you?
The team. Oh, the team said she's finally rejected Simbu to be with the guy whom she's seen with on the Brooklyn Bridge, you know. Right, so that is one of the factors why we didn't pinpoint this guy being the husband.
Right.
She's married and she settled down there, not because she got a chance to go to New York or anything. So I remember saying this thing, in the 70s, 80s, that would be relevant, but not now.
Yeah.
She, finally, it's the easy way out. Parents should be happy. I'm sacrificing a large part of my mind and my head to be in this space. And let me find love with whoever I want to be with.
Okay. Does she find love?
So we'll know that in part two.
Oh, she comes back as well?
Yeah, she comes back as well.
Okay. What did you get by having Jessie as a person who does not like cinema, who's just seen 5 films in her whole life, and setting her opposite this one guy? Was there just another opposition between the two characters?
Correct.
Or was there something
that
else?
That was the fourth thing. So the father, obviously religion, the fact that she's older, which also can be handled.
Right.
The brother and him not getting on at all.
Right.
And the fourth was, I fell in love with somebody who completely hates film. So these are the families which I know, and obviously the whole, you know, this particular community where, for them, television, movies are all considered sin completely.
Right.
And there are lots of families like that, right? So she's from that sort of a background. And for this guy to fall in love with her seemed like a, you know, it's, and these things will happen in life.
Right.
So I just wanted to toe that line and not move away from that at all, you know.
So where were you going with the fact that the movie, even before Karthik made his movie, the movie that he was working on with K.S. Ravikumar was kind of mirroring his life, because Jesse says that we're going to be apart for 45 days, but the movie situation also, K.S. Ravikumar says, in the hero irukanga, naapathanji naal paathukala, something like that. Where were you going with that?
It's just a metaphor, just a parallel thought sort of a thing.
Okay.
And I think it also came up because of the score that I managed to get at that point, you know. So I just thought, let's mirror the moments.
Okay.
I think he even say, "Unak therimada nalla vada," and stuff like that, you know.
Yeah.
So all that was built on location. We had to figure out something for Ravikumar sir to do.
Right.
So I remember writing that on the day of shoot, saying, let's just keep parallel situations and not really break our heads into finding out what film they're making, sort of a thing.
Okay.
So we just went to that call.
So let's talk about Karthik a bit. So he's a boxer. Did you have the bit just so that you could have an action sequence, or did
No, I somehow wrote it. I wrote it in.
Okay.
And then it worked out that there was a fight sequence between the two of them. Not a fight, just a scuffle sort of thing.
Right.
And then it extends into this guy bringing some guys into the shuttle club where they're playing badminton and stuff, and then they take on Simbu.
Right.
And he says, this seemed easy to me because I am a boxer and I could handle these guys well. So we had moments of him in the initial training rounds when he's walking through, I mean, the initial opening portions of the film where he's walking through AVM and stuff. But there's a little bit of all that you can see.
Right.
There'll be a Mike Tyson poster on the wall and stuff. I don't know if people noticed all that. And a Scorsese sort of thing, you know. So, yeah.
The other really interesting thing that really worked out for this film was that the hero does not have a friend of his own age.
Yeah.
He has this Ganesh. And how did that come about?
Hugely inspired by me and R.D. Rajshekhar, who made Kaka Kaka with me. Minnali and Kaka Kaka. So obviously we are of different age groups, you know, he's much senior.
The cinematographer?
Yeah.
Okay.
The cinematographer, he worked with Rajiv sir and I worked on the direction side. But somehow we just bonded like crazy, and most of the conversation was about film.
Right.
Different films, his journey from Mayavaram and, you know, me from Tamil Nadu and Trichy and a little bit of Kerala and all that stuff. So when, at the period where I was looking for work, I'd leave home, but I wouldn't want to go back home because there's nothing good to tell people at home. So I go sit in Rajshekhar's small pad and do all my writing there.
Okay.
And he would sit there and discuss film with me.
This is pre-Minale.
Pre-Minale.
Right.
Pre-Minale, almost 4-5 years leading into Minale.
Right.
This is the only thing I'd do. And we'd watch films together. He'd go off for some of his... He also hasn't made a film. And his first film also was Minale, even though he's much senior. So he was doing small ad films and stuff, but we bonded like that. He was hugely inspired by that.
That Indian, where did that come from? That just became so iconic. I don't even know if you expected that.
No, I think it was written in the film. It's not something that came up on location. But also it's because of Ganesh and the delivery and the way he says it.
Right.
That it became strangely a little more cult than, you know, what it should have been, I think. Ganesh has that,
right.
You know. He's somebody in real life also. You know, he comes across as, he wouldn't mind me saying that. He might look and behave a certain way. He might come across somebody being crass, but you can't ignore the man because he will have you in splits. His voice somewhere attracts you in that sort of a way. And that's what I felt will resonate with the audience also.
Okay.
So he became hugely popular. I had wanted Vivek for that role.
Oh.
And Vivek had said no to me for this film. And I don't want to do just a comedy sort of thing, he said. So then, Ganesh was one of the producers of the film, right? So we brought him in. Everybody hated the idea, but I said, this will work. And I think that line sort of, even though people might not like me saying that, became iconic only because of the way he says it.
Let's talk about a couple of editing choices that you made. Man, I know we want to talk about the writing, but I just...
Yeah.
Because you also directed the film.
Yeah, yeah.
Early on, you have a series of intercut sequences between Karthik talking to his father and Karthik talking to Ganesh.
Yeah.
The scenes are intercut. Yeah. Were they intercut in the screenplay itself or with...
No, it was Anthony's call.
Okay.
It was purely Anthony's call. So Anthony is a wizard with stuff like that. Obviously, there's length and then we try to make things work. So a couple of those moments were actually shot like that. He just said it works better if I show in a day what this guy is doing.
Right.
And it was his call to make it like that.
Because it really kind of, it seems faster than it would
had
it been two separate.
That was the idea.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
And on the other thing that I really was interested in is the decision to use these not extraordinary jump cuts, but these very light, disorienting jump cuts. What is that?
Again, Anthony.
Right.
You know, he's, even Kaka Kaka was structured a lot by him, even though there was a lot on paper. He showed me that it was possible. The previous film, I'd worked with Suresh, so with all due respect to him. For me, writing on paper and then translating that to screen, two different things, right?
Right.
I didn't even know these things were possible. He said, we will do it. So I worked a lot with Anthony only because we were trying to break a lot of stereotype ways of filming a sequence and, you know, editing it and stuff. So most of all that you see was completely Anthony's structure. Obviously, it doesn't go without me saying yes, and I've said yes only because I liked it completely. So.
No, but I'm saying as a you know, what does it suggest in the film, the slight disorientation there?
It's supposed to be vignettes, right? It's supposed to be moments.
Okay.
It's just the way of treating that.
The vignettes aspect of it.
Yeah.
Let me ask you about this. The song sequence, when you shoot songs, there are some parts where the characters lip syncs the songs. There are some parts where the song plays behind them and you show them either being or just what one would call the Balu Mahendra style of thing, right?
Montages, right?
So the montage and things like that. Now, so how do you, what is this thing that you've developed? I think nobody else does this thing where, I mean, people either do entire montage kind of thing or they do a lip sync kind of thing. You do this thing where you kind of intersperse both.
So I myself realized that this has become a sort of I'm not putting myself on top here. Recently when we shot a film, Manoj said, sir, unga style la panala, sir. So I said, what? Another half montage. Then only realized there's a pattern now.
Right.
I'm doing it only because for me, when Trisha on the terrace lip syncs the particular line to Simbu, it's her talking to him.
Okay.
The rest of the time, they're actually not talking. They're just being with each other.
Right.
So the lip sync parts are actually conversations that happen between them, but in the form of a musical treatment.
Okay.
That's how it is.
Okay. So when people talk in your films during a song, that's the musical.
Conversation.
That's a conversation.
Conversation in the form of music.
Okay.
Rest of the time, they're actually not talking, they're just being with each other.
Okay.
That's
okay.
It.
That's the thing.
Yeah.
Whereas in a...
Complete lip sync song.
Yeah.
In a complete lip sync song, when it's a complete lip sync song, it's a slight fantasy treatment of a moment, right?
Okay.
Like Undra Renda Asigal.
Right.
It's completely lip sync. Now, when two people are in that moment, you have a song, and I'm just taking it like any other song would be in
which
the world.
Which could still also be a conversing with
which
each
still
other.
Be. Right, but this is particularly lines which I want to know to the audience that this is particular conversation. The rest of the time, they're not actually talking anything.
Okay.
They're just walking hand in hand. You know, he's doing a flip in the air. they're on the bike and stuff like
so,
that.
So, in a Gautham Menon film, yeah. a song sequence, if I see a character mouthing the words, lip-syncing the words, that means that particular line is something they want to particularly express.
When there is montages also.
When there are montages also. Yeah. Okay, yeah. Wow, that's a yeah. rule that you want us to remember. So, I want to talk about your choreography. There are three types of songs that you have in this film. One is like a full-on choreography like Hosanna, and then you have a part choreography, part montage like O Mana Penne, because you see them in the train doing yeah. like it's the exactly. two of them, and then the mood is kind yeah. of conveyed by the choreography, and then you have something like Manipaya, which is no choreography at all.
Yes.
How do you decide one approach versus the
so that all the songs, especially I focus a lot more because with my first outing with Rehman sir, I didn't want to go unprepared. So right. I put a lot of effort into writing the segments. And Vinnaithaandi to a large extent was a full bound script. And then there was a lot of Simbu and Trisha coming in with lots of candid stuff. So songs were etched in. So I clearly described to Rehman sir what the mood is for the first song where there are dancers and stuff. The second song I said is a reflection of what's in his mind when he gets a moment to be with, not a moment, a whole night, to be with her on a train. They're covered by curtains, they're on a side berth sort of thing. And there's a whole night where there's conversation.
Right.
And then somehow her leg just brushes against his hand. He touches her feet, her foot. And then there's leading into a kiss and she pushes him away sort of a thing. But, so he said, okay, so all this is a train. I said, no, sir. We'll cut away to a reflection of his mind, which is a song. So him dancing and walking around and stuff like that. So clearly defined. In a song like Manipaya, and I don't like the idea of normally shooting with dancers. In a Manipaya, there was no need for anything to come in. It was only montages of both of them being in love, and it was Rehman sir's concept of her saying, sorry, I kept you away for so long. In
right.
fact, when we set up a song idea there, he said, okay, ninga kalambanga, he said. I said, sir, I won't compose now, I'll call you. Then Tamare called me one day later and said, she basically goofed up by saying, naalik ena vara solirukkaru, neethu pannom. Neethu panningla. Ayyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoyoy he gave the concept for that song, which I completely love. I just sat back and walked into one mind-blowing song, you know. So, and there was no other way I would have picturized it other than just montages and stuff. Yeah.
You do song screenplays?
I do song screenplays because I think that's the only thing that can inspire a composer to take the song to another level. Otherwise, just telling them, sir, rendu per irukanga or love song, na, he himself will ask me, Gautham, edha pudusa sollunga, he'll say. And I've even with the songs where I tell him proper screenplays, he will ask me, okay, what is that one unique thing that we can pick? Give me a word or give me something.
Right.
So they're on a bike. Acham enbadu madamada, they're on a bike. So he says, okay, they're just on a bike and then, you know, there's lip sync, you'll do that and all that. Yes, I said, yes. So what can we do? Okay, what if there's a bird flying overhead and, you know, he's sort of talking to that bird where you know, he says, let's see who's faster. Maybe because the girl behind
me. Right, right.
So then Tamare comes to Rasali. So it's like magic happening there,
yeah,
you know.
Yeah.
If I don't give him that, he himself will ask me, give me something unique for the song.
So the fact that they're on a bike is already there.
Is already there.
And that inspires the other things.
Everything else.
Okay, so yeah. Your song screenplay is more like, I want all these things to be there in the song.
Exactly.
Or do you even sequence it?
I sequence it also. Okay. I see it in my head. But as the song unfolds, I see it a lot more.
Okay.
Which is why I insist on being on the recording. When the singers sing it, my mind opens up. I note down small points here and there.
Okay.
Once a song is given to me, and hopefully with the final production, which is so important because for every small tweak or a string or a musical interlude, you can actually add so many more elements. I write the song completely when I go to shoot.
Okay.
The song is written much more than my actual scripts.
Tell me about Hosanna in particular.
Yeah.
This is the first time he's falling in love, right?
Yeah.
What made you say, I want choreography in the song rather than show his emotions in a more like in a slightly different manner? Because choreography suggests something else, right? It's more exuberant.
Yeah.
It's more, you know, on a different
but
plane.
But I wanted all that exuberance to come through. It's just that, you know, he becomes sprightly. Something happens to him. He jumps over the gate.
Okay.
And there are people walking with him.
Right.
Initially, he's a little laid back. You see all these guys against a wall. And then slowly they get into the mood. I thought that was what he would feel inside.
Inside, okay.
I really thought that's what he'd feel.
Okay, okay. You usually say that you find your climaxes only after you, start writing the film and even during the shooting.
Yeah.
How was it for this film?
To a large extent, yes. The problem was also because halfway through we picked up a Telugu version. And then we caught up. Okay, so now both the shoots became parallel. And the Telugu producer from the word go was insisting, I don't know where you're going to go with this. but this has to be a happy ending sort of thing. And I said, the film will work only if, you know, they move apart and then he ends up doing something about that.
Right.
Because he's a filmmaker and I'm leading towards that. So she argued with me and then she convinced me that Telugu, it won't work. I'm the producer of Telugu film, so let's do that. I said, right. It's not a film, but then, okay, I'll give you something which is commercial. That's all. But, and Telugu became a big hit, actually. It was much more appreciated straight away to be a commercial success than Tamil. Tamil took some time to settle down and then, you know, what it became. But eventually, they actually were like, Tamil is not going to work types, you know.
Right.
So, the climax, around 70% of the film, I was very sure. We had a discussion, I know, and I said, this is how it's going to play out. There was a call in the treatment of the climax where you see Trisha, there's a line which you don't see. So there's one part of the film where, I mean, there's one part of the moment where Trisha actually walks away. She doesn't come back to him. There's a little Anthony's treatment there. That was completely Anthony.
Okay.
He suggested that idea saying, let's just not fool the audience, but let's just go with the fact that this is going to be what he sees on screen. But then when you look back, she actually didn't come to him on the bridge, but she went away with her husband.
Which is what she tells him later.
Which is what tells him later. Right. But that idea was Anthony's.
Okay, okay.
Yeah.
So you built it in later.
I built it in later, okay. Correct.
So finally, the title, you got it from Minsara Kanava's song.
Yeah.
What made you think that this was the right title?
Vinnilave was what I started writing with.
Okay. That was the original title.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then Jessie. But then obviously it was not like what I would want to put out, which is a working title sort of a thing. And there was a discussion.
Which is the name of the film that Karthik makes.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So then there was a discussion and then it was Manoj who came up with, so what about the next line? Vinnaithaandi Varuvaayaa. People said no, lengthy and all, but I love the whole fact that people are opposing something. I said, let's just go with this.
Okay. So it suggested to you that the difficulty of the...
Exactly. And it worked so well with the film. Once Manoj, everybody heard the script. The whole Kerala, the mood, everything was set by Manoj to a large extent. Like, I just let him pick the locations and I worked the scenes into that. So when everybody knew the story in the team, and then when the whole idea was about, will this girl be able to take that step, will she cross the line and come for me? So will you travel over the moon for me was perfect, you know?
Right,
so.
Right. So what can you tell us about the sequel?
The fact that Simbu is not playing it is a little bothering. But I think all these actors are like, we want to do solo films and, you know, this. It's a hero film, actually. It's about four heroes.
Oh.
Yeah. So it's Karthik and his best friends from college.
Okay.
Who are, there's a boy from Bangalore, there's a boy from Trivandrum, and there's a boy from Hyderabad.
Okay.
So it's essentially Panchatantram, but with four heroes, I'm saying.
Okay.
And each of them gets a version of their own. Like Puneet Rajkumar will have a Kannada version because the first 10 minutes of the film will be in Kannada.
Okay.
And then when they meet, his interaction with somebody in the film will be in Kannada. The Malayalam boy's voiceover will run over the entire film. So it's a Malayalam film essentially also.
Okay.
But somehow most of our stars don't want to be in a four hero film sort of a thing. But I'm really happy right now that Maddie has agreed to play that role.
Which role?
Simbu's role, as in
Karthik. As an old, the 8 years later.
8 years later, okay. Karthik's role is going to be reprise is not the word to use right now.
Right.
But Maddie is playing that and we've got Puneet Rajkumar and Tovino. The Telugu angle is not fixed as yet. Right. And Rahman sir has agreed to do the music right now. What happens is, 8 years from now, we pick up the story of Karthik. Just to give you an idea, he's made four films. Hotshot filmmaker, completely lost the concept of love. He's with a lot of women. And, you know, much to the disgust of his sister and his family and stuff like that. There's a lot of banter.
Right.
And these four friends connect all the time and they've got nothing to do with films. One guy owns a couple of restaurants. The other guy is a car dealership owner. The fourth boy is an IT guy from Kerala and stuff like that. They decide to travel together, taking a break from their work for a fifth friend's wedding. But the film is not a hangover. It's an emotional, fun-filled journey.
Okay, all right. Thanks, Gautham. All the best for the film.
Thank you.
Thanks. Thank you.